بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, we've reached to the beginning of this story of Ashab al-Kahf from وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. And just before this, the last ayah was نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ. Allah Azza wa Jal, He ended the introduction by saying, we narrate unto you their story بالحق, with truth and accuracy and precise detail. And you'll see exactly what kind of precise detail Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us. He says then, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. No doubt about it, they were young men that believed in their Lord. The idea here is that later on, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to recite this surah to a group of Christians and to the Jews as well. So this is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept the Christians in contact with the story. The fact that he said, فِدْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. They were young men that believed in their Lord. The Jews would say, yeah, keep going. We agree with you so far, right? Because to them, their Lord was Jesus. Therefore, the Christians, their Lord was Jesus. So, yani for now, they can keep hearing the story and they're interested. آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. They believed in their Lord. Muslims are saying that they believed in Allah. And the Jews say, the Christians say that they believed in Jesus. And it's all good. We will give you our ears and we'll keep hearing. And as I said to you, the first five ayat are just an introduction. So things are really vague. Now later on, Allah Azza wa Jal will tell us who exactly is their Rabb. That'll become clear. So, آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَىٰ. And once they have believed and they committed and they accepted this belief inside of them and they convinced about it, then after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increased them in guidance. And that exactly the whole surah will be explaining what kind of guidance did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide for them. How the sun was guided to work for them. How the sun did them a favor. And how everything around them did them a favor as well, as they were sleeping in that cave for most of their life. So now Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Now here what is happening is, as I mentioned to you, that the city with the very oppressive tyrant king at the time, they worshipped idols and they worshipped statues. And these young men, they were still upon the pure, authentic version of the deen of Isa alayhi salam. So they're still holding upon La ilaha illallah, and they haven't turned their back away from this word. And basically the king and the community worship idols. Every now and then they worship. And these young men are never to be found worshipping the idols. So some people dubbed them into the king, into the court system of the community. And what happened is that the king found out, he got really upset, he got really angry. And so he's going to bring them into trial, these young men. And of course, he sends after them the guards, the soldiers. They go, they grab them. And now a couple of young men are being dragged into court, really nervous and terrified and scared. And the whole community gathers to see what kind of ruling is going to happen. And by the way, as they're going to court, the judge is going to be the king. Because at the time, the king was always the judge. So he's going to be their judge. And the death or the verdict is known. It's going to be the death sentence because they've refused the religion of the community and the state itself. So the sentence is going to be death. That's it, they're on death row. There's no argument about this. And now they're being dragged by the soldiers inside of this court. You can just expect and understand how nervous and frightened and shaken they are. Like right now, you know, maybe a teenager is outside on the street in his car, he's driving, you know, big, he sees himself over everyone. And then if the police was to pull him over, you know, what kind of attitude would he give? How would he talk and explain himself? It's a nervous time, right? Because some authority or someone that is higher than you has pulled you over for a mistake and you might cop a serious consequence for it. So these brothers, these young men, they're not just going to serve 10 months in prison or 1 year in prison. This is death sentence. So this is some serious stuff. And you're going to expect that as they walk in and they're told, explain yourself, well, we're going to expect that these people are going to apologize and they're going to be remorseful. And it's all right, look, please forgive us and we're going to go worship the idols now.
Maybe that's what we would have expected. So Allah Azza wa Jal now, He tells us that they were nervous. And He tells us that they were frightened and they were shaken. So He says, وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. We tied on their hearts, meaning we gave their hearts strength and firmness and courage and braveness and confidence. إِذْ قَابُوا, when they got up in the court, and now the king is saying to them, Allah, explain yourselves. Why are you worshipping our idols? Get up and explain yourself. For they get up, إِذْ قَابُوا, and they were terrified. But Allah Azza wa Jal gave them strength and firmness عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ, in their heart. إِذْ قَابُوا, they got up all together, and now they're going to explain themselves. فَقَالُوا, they all said, in other words, this is a plural, all of them are saying at the same time, رَبُّنَا رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. This is the first part. They said, our Lord is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. Now when He said, آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ, they believed in their Lord. Now it's being explained, what Lord did they believe in? Now the Jews and the Christians cannot agree with this part of the story, but Allah Azza wa Jal makes it clear. They get up and they say, our Lord is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. SubhanAllah, yani you'd think that is enough. Khalas, you explain yourself. But the kind of strength Allah gave them kept them going. لَن نَدْعُوَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهَ. We will never call anyone besides Him an ilah. And they kept going. لَقَدْ قُلْنَا إِذًا شَطَطَ. In that case, if we do call someone besides Him an ilah, we would have said something outrageously stupid. Yani with that, it's like they're saying that the king is stupid. In other words, this is what they're doing. Yani, number one, our Lord is the Lord of the heavens and the earth. On top of that, we will never call besides Him an ilah. On top of that, if we do that, we would have said something incredibly stupid and outrageously stupid. In other words, you king, you're one of these people that are stupid. Well, SubhanAllah, they're not done yet. They turn to their people, now they ignore the king, and they look at their people and they say, Ha'ula, these people here that have gathered to see our sentence and to witness what's going to happen to us. Qawmuna, these people are our people. These are our people. Ittakhadhu min dunihi aliha. They took and they worshipped a Lord besides him. Right? Ittakhadhu min dunihi aliha. Law la ya'tuna alayhim bisultanin bayyin. How come they don't come up with any clear evidence? And in other words, the boys are saying, why are you putting us on trial? But these people should be put on trial. What kind of evidence do you have to worship that idol outside? You're the one that's supposed to be on trial, not us. We have every proof for worshipping the Lord that we're worshipping. SubhanAllah, yani incredible words being yani said in this courtroom. لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فمن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا. Who could be more wrong than the one who invents and fabricates a lie against Allah? Yani in other words, no one is more wrong than whoever invents a lie against Allah. In other words, now they have just said to the entire community, you're all liars, and you people worship a fake God. You and your king are all the same. They are warning their people. They're saying you're scared of this king. How about being scared of the king of the heavens and the earth? Right? Where is your proof for doing what you do? So this is yani subhanAllah, braveness and courage that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. And now they're done explaining themselves. For now, obviously, you'd expect that the death sentence is handed. They've just made a mockery out of the king in front of the presence of the entire community. And they have called him stupid in front of the entire community. This is not something that is going to pass like this with no any consequence. So now, before the death sentence could be carried out, they're taken to prison for a while, just so that some formal formalities can finish. Then they'll take him out in front of the community and they'll begin to basically execute them. So they're taken into prison. And as they're in prison, somehow they manage to escape. And they escape this prison and they begin to walk. And this conversation they have as they exit prison, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala records it in the Quran. There is no doubt that there was no one there to hear it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says that these young men spoke to each other. They've just left prison. And Allah says, وَإِذِ اعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ. They're speaking to each other now. And they're saying to each other, when you get far away from them, اعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ, they're saying, look, we just left the prison now. We're still in the vicinity. We're still in the city. When we get far away from the people, from the soldiers, from the authorities. When we get far away from the community and we've left the town, then Allah says, وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَأُوْ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. When you've gone far away from the people, then head towards the cave. But in between that, Allah said, وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This is probably going to be the most amazing lesson in the entire surah. وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Now look, I'm going to translate to you the first part, and you tell me if it makes sense or not. Literally, this is what's being said. And when you get far away from them, comma, they worship none but Allah, comma, then go to the cave. Did that make sense? But that's how the ayah is. Well, really, the ayah is, وَإِذْ يَعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ فَأُوْ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. That's the ayah. But there is an interjection in the middle, and it says, وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Let me explain this concept to you. This in Arabic is known as a جُمْلَ اِعْتِرَاضِيَة. In other words, it's a sentence within a sentence. The purpose of it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expressing His honor and His love for these people. I'll give you an example. Let's say I'm going to give you a lesson about Al-Madinah. And let's say as well that I love Al-Madinah so much that this is how I gave you the lesson. I said to you, brothers, Al-Madinah, man, I love that place, is the city of the beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now what is my sentence? My sentence is, Al-Madinah is the city of the beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what did I add in between? I added, man, I love that city. In other words, I said Al-Madinah, and I was so overwhelmed with this word, I couldn't continue express except that I express how much I love this place. I literally couldn't continue except that I say how much I love this place, then I moved on. So what is happening, wallahu a'lam, is that Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, وَإِذْ اَعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ. Allah is recording their conversation to each other. And they're saying to each other, when you get far away from the people and the city, then Allah paused. And then He expressed His honor and His love to these people. And He said, وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Look at these people. They worship none but Allah. Now He continued their conversation, فَأُوْ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. Go to the cave, go towards the cave. And he, subhanAllah, it is something that is really, really profound. I mean, these people are fitya. Yani we said young men, in other words, teenagers, in their early teenage years, that's a fitya. And you know, yani as a fitya, or as a person in life, you have two paths. You can either take a path of freedom, that is, now what's freedom? Do whatever you want, eat whatever you want, sleep whenever you want, wake up whenever you want, hang out with whoever you want, do whatever you want. That's a path of freedom. And there's another path, it's the path of restriction. And you're restricted by certain things. You gotta wake up at a certain time, sleep at a certain time, eat certain things, avoid certain things. You gotta worship at certain times. That's restriction. As a young man, what are you more likely to choose? The path of freedom or restriction? Path of freedom. People take the path of freedom. But Allah Azza wa Jal, He expresses His love towards the people by saying, even though they had that path, they didn't decide to choose it. They decided to go to a court that's opposite to freedom. They decided to go to prison that's opposite freedom. They decided now to head towards a cave that's opposite freedom. They did all this for the sake of Allah. Allah is very proud with them, very proud moment. So He mentions their story and He says that they said to each other, when you get far away from the city, Allah stopped. And He said that these people worship none but Allah. He says Allah expressing His love and His honor towards these people. Then He continued, they said to each other, فَأُوْ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. Turn towards the cave. They said Al-Kahf. This is different to saying فَأُوْ إِلَى كَهْفٍ. كَهْفٍ would have meant turn towards a cave, any cave. We had no idea where we're going. But that wasn't said. They said turn to the cave. In other words, they know the cave. They've been there. And remember last week we mentioned that is the cave they used to go there more than once. Ashab al-Raqim, they used to read their Raqim, their book, like the Quran that we have. They used to worship Allah, they used to revise their deen there. So now, فَأُوْ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. They're running, and you know, what are you going to expect them to think? We're going to go towards a cave. We're going to enter a cave. What are we going to do in there? How long are we going to survive in there? Is there food in there? Is there water in there? Are you sure there's no snakes? There's no webs in there? There's no spiders in there? How long are we going to stay in a cave for? They didn't think like that. They didn't even speak like that. As they're heading towards the cave, Al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, he mentions it was about 10 kilometers away from the city. They said to themselves, listen to this. They said, فَأْوُوا إِلَى الْكَهْفِ يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. They said, let's head towards the cave. Allah would shower us with His mercy. يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ. And on top of that, يُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. Allah Azza wa Jal would change and mold our situation so that He makes it easier and comfortable for us. مِرْفَقًا, it comes from the word marfiq, and a marfiq is a pillow. And it comes from the word rafiq. Rafiq is a friend, a kind of friend that you can lean on, like you can use like a pillow. You find comfort and ease with him. And this is amazing. A couple of boys are looking at a cave that is jagged and harsh in its conditions, sharp, darkness, gloomy inside, and they saw it as a source of mercy. They said, we'll walk in there and Allah would shower us with His mercy, you know, and Allah would make it a pillow for us. Who looks at a piece of rock and says it's going to be a pillow for him? In other words, this is teaching us husn of dhan billah. That these young men had husn of dhan billah. That even in the worst of situations, you're coming to a dead end in your life right now. Behind you is the community, they're about to kill you. In front of you, there's a cave. Allahu alam, what's inside of it? And they can still see it and manage to be certain and convince themselves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to shower His mercy upon us. And that the cave is going to be a pillow for us. If you walk on a bit of stone on the earth, yeah, what happens? You scream from, yani if you were to walk on some stone, barefooted. What happens, you know? How uncomfortable is that? These people are about to sleep inside of a cave. Wallahu a'lam what's inside. And before they get there, they're convinced that this is going to be the best sleep they have in there. This is husn of dhan billah. Not a single doubt in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all. And you know, the other interesting thing is from the language perspective, they said yanshur and yuhayyi'. And these two verbs, they have a sukoon at the end. Yani this is called the inner state of jazm. Let me explain to you this. In Arabic, you cannot just put a sukoon at the end of a fi'l like that. At the end of a verb, you cannot just put a sukoon. You're supposed to have a dhamma by default. So the ayah, we were expecting yanshuru lakum rabbukum min rahmatihi wa yuhayyi'u lakum min amrikum mirfaqa. But it didn't come like that. It came in an abnormal way. Yanshur, sukoon. And that sukoon in Arabic, it's called al-jazm. And interestingly enough, jazm in Arabic means certainty. Ya'ani, jazamu, they were certain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to shower them with His mercy. No doubt at all. Well, what you're learning, my brother, ya'ani, that when you get to a point in life, in whatever fitna you're facing in life, always have husn of dhan billah. The believer, whatever he sees, he can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy through it. And the hadith comes to teach us that أَنَا عِنْدَ حُسْنِ ظَنِّ عَبْدِ بِي فَلْيَظُنَّ بِمَا شَاءَ. I am to my servant as he thinks. You think good, you'll only see good. You think bad, all you'll get is bad from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be careful how you think with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these young men are being tested in their deen, not in their dunya. And this is the worst kind of fitna you'll ever be tested in life, is to be tested in your deen. In your deen. And they still look how firm and look how positive they are. يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. Bismillah, they get up the mountain and they head towards the cave and they go inside of this cave. They walk inside. And at the beginning of the story, Allah told us that as soon as they entered the cave, what did they say? إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. What did they say? فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. That's at the beginning, it's in the trailer, that ayah. It's not mentioned now. So they said this dua, and now they're about to put their heads down to sleep. This has been a long day for them in the court. Then they ran this entire distance, 10 kilometers, until they reached the cave. It's a long distance. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says, دَخَلُوا الْكَهْفَ أَوَّلَ النَّهَارِ. They entered the cave at the يعني, the first hour of the nahar. In other words, like at dhuhr time. So it's been a long day now. You'd expect to be exhausted, tired, shaken, worried from the inside, but full of certainty and hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of their situation. So they're about to put their heads down to sleep. They put their heads down in the middle of the cave to sleep. And they sleep upon that sincere intention. They sleep, the last thing they said was Allah. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِن لَّدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. That's the last thing they slept upon. That was the last concern. They slept with a concern that, Ya Allah, when we sleep and wake up, you know, help us in remaining obedient and in worship to you and not to anyone else. Do you ask yourself, what is your concern? What do you think about every time you put your head down on the pillow and you sleep? What concerns you? These people, they're concerned for their deen and they're afraid with it by their deen. That the day they ran away from the prison, they didn't even have time to go back to their mothers and hug their mothers and their fathers. They had no time. They ran away and they went to the cave, and little did they know, it's all just going to begin right now. Everything is going to change. So they put their heads down, expecting to sleep for a few hours before we're going to get up and Allahu A'lam, Allah help us, how are we going to save ourselves from this situation? They put their head down and it's just going to become something now the entire universe is going to work for. Allah Azza wa Jalla now explains in a few ayat that sleep of theirs that went on for 300 years. Because most of their life was spent sleeping. So most of the story would be spent explaining that sleep. So Allah Azza wa Jalla now, he says, وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ. They've just began their sleep. They're a couple of hours into their sleep. And now it's the next day and the third day. And every single day Allah is saying, وَتَرَى. And you see and you visualize the sun when it rises. Well, what sun? We're not seeing anything now. But Allah Azza wa Jalla wants you to visualize the sun. It is like you've been taken from where you're sitting and you're put on the mountain right next to where their cave is. And you're said, look at the sun every time it comes up. My brothers, the cave, it had two openings. And let's say this was their cave. Their cave had two openings. There was an opening from the eastern side and there was an opening from the western side. And there's an opening from where the sun rises and there's an opening from where the sun sets. It had two sides, the mountain, the cave, two openings. Allah says, وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ كَهْفِهِمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينَ. He said, you'll see every time the sun rose, the rays would come, they'll reach until the mouth of the cave. And then what would the rays do? تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ كَهْفِهِمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينَ. The rays would bend towards the right, The rays would not go inside. They would bend towards the right. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now making the sun work for their favor. And when one has certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the sun would serve him. Well, subhanallah, bin Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that the sun would avoid them because had it entered, it would have burnt them and their clothes. Imagine 300 years of the sun coming in, what's going to happen to you? You'd fry, it'd become barbecue inside. So he says, يَعْنِي لَأَحْرَقَتْهُمْ وَأَحْرَقَتْ ثِيَابَهُمْ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the rays turn. The other thing is, that for you to get into a deep sleep, you need darkness. So if light came in, no good, might wake him up. So the light would be turned and bent towards the right. And as a result, as they're inside, the cave remained in darkness. وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ. يعني, you think of this, 300 years. Every day of 300 years, the sun is coming up and the rays are bending. And it's happening twice because as it sets as well, Allah says, تَقْرِضُهُمْ ذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. It turns, it bends away from them towards the left. But تَقْرِضُهُمْ comes from the word قَرْض. And قَرْض meaning to give someone a loan, to give someone a favor, a loan. So in other words, when it sets, it does them a favor. It gives them some sun. Just as it's about to go, it gives them some sun. Ya'ni al-ulama, rahimahumullah, they mentioned that the body needs at least 3 to 5 minutes of sunlight daily. So it remains functioning and in active mode. So that sun at the end, as the sun is setting, which now the rays are minimal and they don't hurt and they don't irritate, it comes in, it gives them some light, so their bodies remain functioning all the time. SubhanAllah. The sun is going up. and it's setting twice a day for 300 years. Yani that's over 1,200 miracles that happened for these people. 1,200 miracles, every single day a miracle for these people. Well, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with someone and Allah gives. There is no limit unto what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives. مَا يَفْتَحِ اللَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ مِنْ رَحْمَةٍ فَلَا مُمْسِكَ لَهَا. Any kind of rahmah Allah would open for the people, no one can hold it back. 120,000 miracles, even more, and what is going to happen is even more. Subhanallah. The sun is coming up and it's coming down. And you know, incredible, even nowadays, when people build a house or getting an approval for a building or whatever, you gotta make sure that you take into consideration the windows and the sunlight that comes in and the air that's gonna come in, right? You can't put the window wherever you want. You're gonna have to, there's a regulation for it. Well, this, subhanAllah, this cave that they're in is custom made. Allah guided them to the best of caves, in where it gets sunlight that comes in on the other end, and the sunlight from here is avoided. وَهُمْ فِي فَجْوَةٍ مِنْ. And as they were sleeping, they were in the middle of the cave. Well, the cave is open from two ends. You know, when you're in the house and you open the window and the door, what happens on a windy day? If you open the window and the door at the same time, isn't it like this breeze comes in, right? This cave, it's like a hotel. And you think of on the 15th level of a hotel, mashallah, it's on the shores of the Gold Coast, and you're sitting and you've got your legs out on the balcony, you've opened the door of the balcony, and you've opened the window of the hotel, and the breeze is coming in like this, refreshing the air, giving you like a cool breeze, subhanallah. That's what's happening. They're in the middle of the cave, and the cool breeze is coming in from both ends. It's refreshing the environment, the air inside, and some sunlight is given to them at the end. Subhanallah. Yani really this place became a mirfaqa. Does the sun know the cave? Does the sun know what the cave is? No. An kahfim. It bends from their cave. Yani the sun knows who's inside of the cave. That's what it knows, and it's helping that. Subhanallah. Wahum fi fajwatin min. Dhalika min ayatillah. This is from the great signs and the miraculous signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ. Anyone who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to guide, فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ. He's the guided one. Everything around him will be guided for his favor. وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُ وَلِيًّا مُرْشِدًا. And anyone who is led astray, then you will find no guiding friend for them. Now Allah azza wa jal continues to describe an even more epic scene of their sleep. He says, this is on the outside. That sun and that is on the outside. Now we go inside. وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاظًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ. You assume them to be asleep while they're awake. You'd assume them, when you see them, وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاظًا, you'd assume that they're awake. But really they were asleep. In other words, their eyes were open. For 300 years they slept with their eyes open. But وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ, they were in a deep sleep. Why? Because of the, وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ, and ulama mentioned as well, that because of the fluid in the eye, that if the eye was to close for about a year, you'd become blind. So Allah Azza wa Jal kept their eyes open so that the fluid and the water in their eye is refreshed every time the wind would strike it. وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَافًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ. What a scary sight that is. That you walk in there and they're all laying down with their eyes wide open. وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ. وَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينَ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. Allah Azza wa Jal's favor upon them never ended. وَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ, and we turn them to their right and to their left. وَنُقَلِّبُ is a present tense. In other words, we continuously turn them to their right and to their left. You know, just like a mother, when she gives birth to her baby, a new baby born in the cot, what happens? She comes every few hours and she moves him left and she moves him right so that his muscle relaxes and he doesn't develop any pain and any soreness in his muscle. The people now that are in a coma, every now and then the nurse is going to come in and turn them and sort of massage so that it develop bed sores. That's what's going to happen. Here, no nurse is turning them. وَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ, Allah Himself is turning them left and right so that their bodies don't deteriorate over a long time, and so that the insects don't eat their bodies, and so that they don't lose function and mobility in their muscles and in their limbs. فَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. opinions would mention that every time the sun would rise, Allah Azza wa Jal would turn their faces away from it. And when it sets, Allah would turn them the other way from it. يعني سبحان الله ونقلبهم ذات اليمين وذات الشمال وكلبهم باسط ذراعيه بالوصيل. And the dog, they had a dog that came with them. He got mentioned in the Quran as well. Ibn Kathir al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, he says that dog was honored because he يعني was in contact with يعني good brothers, with يعني with a companion, a good companion. He got honored because he was hanging out with righteous people. So Allah Azza wa Jal made mention of him in the Quran. Not once, almost 4 or 5 times his mention is in the Quran. يعني every time you say the word كلبهم, you're getting حسنات. Ahmed, he's dog. He was honored because of his love and because of his يعني صحبة, they call it, his companionship with the righteous. What was he doing? بَاسِطٌ ذِرَاعَيْهِ بِالْوَصِيدِ. He was at the mouth of the cave. Al-Wasid is the entrance of the cave. That's where he was. And he was sitting with a position in where his paws were stretched out. And بَاسِطٌ is an ism fa'al, it's a noun. In other words, the dog wasn't moving left and right. Allah wasn't turning him. He remained in one position. He remained in that position of guard, in that position of attack. You know, when a dog is sitting and he's got his paws stretched out, what does that mean? That means he's ready to attack. He's ready to defend. He's there as a security. Yani even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the dog work in favor for Ashab al-Kahf. Everything is working for them now. Everything is a favor for them. وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِطٌ ذِرَاعَيْ بِالْوَصِيلِ. And you know, if you were to look inside this cave, is there darkness in there or it's light? It's dark. So if you actually went there, all you're gonna see is two paws sticking out. That's all you'd see. وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِطٌ ذِرَاعَيْهِ بِالْوَصِيلِ. Why was the dog at the entrance, not inside? Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he says, because it was the angels that would turn Ashab al-Kahf left and right, and the angels don't enter a house in which there's a dog. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moved the dog outside so that the angels are able to enter and يعني, turn the people of the Kahf left and right by the permission and the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah now says, لَوِ اطَّلَعْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Had you seen them? Had you had the chance to have a sort of a peek inside the cave? Low meaning if, in other words, this didn't happen and no one ever saw them. But if, let's say someone did see them, لو اطلعت عليهم, he said, لو وليت منهم فرار. Imagine, you went up now a cave, you went up a mountain and you saw a cave and you saw two paws sticking out. What are you gonna do? Were you gonna poke it with a stick, yani? What are you gonna do? You run. You're terrified, you're afraid, you're scared. The ayah said, لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا. يعني لَوَلَّيْتَ doesn't only mean you would have ran away. وَلَّيْتَ, that's تَوَلَّيْتَ would have meant you run away, right? وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّ, for example, here, لَوَلَّيْتَ. And وَلَّيْتَ is different to تَوَلَّيْتَ. يعني Allah did not say, لَتَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ. He said, لَوَلَّيْتَ. لَوَلَّيْتَ is actually, it's a fa'il in Arabic, it's known as لازم ومتعدي, it's transitive and intransitive. In other words, you would have ran away and made others run away. يعني as you're running and screaming down the mountain, you're saying to everyone, go back, go back. لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا. And your heart would have been full of terror. Can you see two poles and people just sleeping and their eyes are open and turning left and right and they got no idea what's happening. And يعني something scary. ولملئت منهم رعبا. Your heart would have been full of terror. At that sight you would have seen, subhanAllah, يعني terror, يعني in other words, please don't talk about it. I don't want to speak about what I saw. I might have a nightmare and a dream, just close that topic, just move on to something else. This is وَلَا مُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا. And this now happened for 300 years, they're about to wake up now. 300 years are gone, generations have changed, people have died, people have gone, people have lived, whatever it is. Now they're about to wake up and they get up. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَكَذَٰلِكَ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ. And in the state they were in, that state of 300 years they were in, just like that, we resurrected them. بَعَثْنَاهُمْ. See the word بَعَثْنَاهُمْ? بَعَثْنَاهُمْ, يعني we resurrected them. It's used for people that are dead. But Allah Azza wa Jalla, he compared their sleep to a death. He says, now long after 300 years, we resurrected them. لِيَتَسَاءَلُوا بَيْنَهُمْ. لم يعني Allah, meaning in other words, as soon as they got up, soon after, this is what they spoke to each other. A conversation that is happening inside of a cave among a few young men. Who's going to listen to that? What kind of historian was there to record exactly what was mentioned? Nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was there to hear this conversation, and it is so incredible and awesome and full of lessons that he made it part of his Quran. Young boys talking to each other became part of the Quran. Until the day of judgment, you're reciting it. لِيَتَسَاءَلُوا بَيْنَهُمْ لِيَتَسَاءَلُوا. They got up and they're still confused, they're still worried. No, they're expecting, يعني, they asked each other, كَمْ لَبِثْتُمْ. How long have you been here for? So one of them, يعني, I don't know, لَبِثْنَا يَوْمًا, probably one day. Then he looked outside, أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمًا, because we came in here, it was dhuhr time, the sun was here. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said they woke up akhir al-nahar. They woke up at the end of the day. In other words, like close to asr time. That's akhir al-nahar. So in other words, sun was there, it's there now. Maybe ba'dayaw, part of a day. So another, this is one group of them said that. Another group didn't accept that. They said, nah, I don't think so. Maybe we've been here a bit longer than a day or half a day. So they said, خَسَعَمِيَ رَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. Your Lord knows best how long we left. That doesn't matter right now. The thing that worries now is we're hungry and go get us food. So they said, فَبْعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ بِوَرِقِكُمْ هَذِهِ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا. That's what's worrying us right now. 300 years. They haven't eaten for 300 years. Yani, what kind of hunger is happening with these boys right now? So they say, ابْعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ. Send any one of you now. Send him with the money of yours. Look at the word, فَبْعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ. Yani, this truly, truly, wallahi, if anything, it teaches you what brotherhood is about. Really, it teaches you what brotherhood is really about. Send any one of you. Yani, who nowadays, you know, some people, when there's like a meeting, or there's like a, let's say a gathering, there's a discussion on some sort of Islamic community event, and we get some volunteers. And then we begin to divide the work on the volunteers. We say, brother, you get us the drinks, you get the, what is it called, the cutlery and that, you get for us the barbecue, and you get for, and some people are, why did he say to me, get that? Why am I supposed to get that for? Or we're sitting in a meeting, brother, look, take some money and go get us some food and come back. Why did they tell me to do that? Look here. فَبْعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ. Send any one of you, because it doesn't matter who you send. We're all the same anyway. So no one felt offended. Send me, why are you sending me back to the city to get food? No one cared. Let's go, we're all the same, Aslam. And then look what they said, look how close this brotherhood is. بِوَرِقِكُمْ هَذِهِ. Send him with your money. With your money. Whose money? Who are, Aslan, is there a difference? What I have in my pocket is exactly what you have in your pocket. This is the brotherhood, this is بِوَرِقِكُمْ, your money. Yani, in other words, subhanAllah, until that happens, then that would be true brotherhood. That the day what's in my pocket, is this the same as what's in your pocket? The time I stretch my hand into your pocket and I take it and it's like the same, you don't care? That is what brotherhood is about. That is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did between the Ansar and Muhajirun. That when the Muhajirun came to Medina, they gave them half their wealth. They gave them half their wealth and half their property and what they own. That is exactly what Islam came to do. These Ashab al-Kahf were true brothers. They stood in court together. They slept together. They woke up together. They're about to eat together. They worshipped Allah together. Everything in the story was together. And all of it was in the plural sense. فَأُوْ اِعْتَزَلْتُمُوْهُمْ إِذْ قَامُوا. You know, it's all in the plural sense. This was the kind of brotherhood they had. So فَبْعَثُوا أَحَدَكُمْ بِوَرِقِكُمْ هَذِهِ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. Send any one of you with this money of ours. Send him to Al-Madina, to the city that we came out from. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا. فَلْيَنْظُرْ, meaning let him look carefully. Which is the most أَزْكَى طَعَام. Meaning which is the most halal food. أَزْكَى يعني halal. You look at the worry they're in and they're still concerned about eating al-halal. You know, at this time, it's all right. Maybe go and eat anything because you're excused and you're about to get killed. And you don't want to be yani known in the community. You don't want to expose yourself. So just eat anything. Even then, doesn't give them an excuse. Make sure you get azka ta'aman. Get the food that is halal. Subhanallah. Because the worry and the concern and the love they had for Allah, they won't do anything except under the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا فَلْيَأْتِكُمْ بِرِزْقٍ مِنْ Come with some food. Don't come with eight burgers and 10 boxes of pizza and that. Not that so much. Why? Because you'll bring attention to yourself. People are like, where are you going with all that food? And they'll come and they'll expose us. بِرِزْقٍ مِنْهُ Some food. وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ Now they're giving him advice. وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ Be latif. Be very careful and cautious. Be courteous. In other words, when you go down and you put your order on the food, don't, it's been half an hour, where's the food? No, you'll bring attention. Be courteous, be nice, be loving and caring. Don't bring any unwanted attention to yourself. We don't want anything. يَتَلَطَّفْ وَلَا يُشْعِرَنَّ بِكُمْ أَحَدًا And don't allow anyone to notice you. And just before he leaves, they look at each other, and this is a strong lesson Allah teaches. Listen to what they say. They say to each other, listen, إِنَّهُمْ إِن يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ If this city that we just ran away from, if they grab us and they catch us, يَرْجُمُوكُمْ They're gonna stone us. In other words, what was the original sentence for them to be killed? Right? That was how they were going to be killed, stoned to death. أَوْ يُعِيدُوكُمْ فِي مِلَّتِهِمْ They're either going to stone us to death, or they're going to put so much pressure on us and eventually force us to abandon our deen. And if we did that, لَن تُفْلِحُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا You'll never be successful. You know what that's called? What is that? That is called, don't be overconfident in your deen. That is called, don't be overconfident in your deen. They didn't look at each other and say, we've done it before. We were in court, or mashallah, we spoke and we didn't fear anything except Allah. You know, they didn't do that. They realized that that was something Allah gave them. But it might, maybe the second time around, Allah doesn't give us anything of steadfastness in our heart. So boys, don't be too excited over yourself. We might not do, we might not be able to do this again. So be very careful, please. أَوْ يُعِدُوكُمْ فِي مِلَّتِهِمْ We might be returned. You learn from this, don't put yourself in a fitna. You learn from this, do not put yourself in a fitna because you don't know. Maybe you survived one fitna. Maybe you are, mashallah, like you ripped everything in the first fitna. But what guarantees you that you're going to beat the next fitna that comes? Sometimes, there are movies that come out, or things that are written about Islam. We say to the people, brothers, don't read it. Wallah, it's very horrible. What's inside of it will create a lot of doubt in your deen. Don't read it, don't watch it. What do you mean? What kind of it? I'll watch it, and I'm going to watch it, I'm going to read it, I'm going to keep reading. Nothing is going to affect my deen, brother. Yalla, go. He goes and he watches and he comes back with I got doubt in, so can you clear it for me? Who told you to watch it? Why do you throw yourself into the fitna for? And the young boys are teaching us this, wallahi, it's a lesson. أَوْ يُعِيدُوكُمْ فِي مِلَّتِهِمْ صحيح, they were brave at the first time. They had confidence the first time. Allah gave it to them. But nothing is going to guarantee them they can beat the second fitna if it came to them. So please, don't put us in any trouble. Don't put us in any problem. Go get us food and come back. He went. He took off. One of them, very intelligent, very smart. Someone very wise must have went down. He's got to be patient. He's got to be good. He's going down. He's got the money with him. He's going here. Little does he know that he's been 300 years. And the towns and the cities have changed. And he's walking in. The food menu that existed 300 years ago. Who's going to understand what he's going to order? So he walks down. He's amazed. The streets have changed. The buildings have changed. Someone's talking on the phone. And their words, he's talking to himself or what? 300 years ago, no one saw that. Just imagine now 300 years ago, someone slept 300 years ago, woke up now. And he walks among us. And he sees something flying in front of him. What was that? A car or something. And then he looks up the building. There's a house up there. There's a person. How did you get up there? What happened? Where's the restaurants? Where's the places? Where's everything? Subhanallah, really, they would have said someone that is brave. But at the same time, the community saw him. The people at that time now saw him. What's this guy doing? There's a circus here or what? Why is he wearing like that? Why is his head like that? Why is his hair like that? Why is his clothes like that? What's his coin he's holding in his hand? And I've seen that in the museum. What's it doing in his hand? It's a 300-year-old coin. For there's this meeting and there's this strangeness. He turns around and he begins to run back to the cave. As he runs back to the cave, the people follow him. So they run after him. He gets up to the cave and he goes inside of the cave and he realizes that all his brothers have died. They've all died. He walks in the cave, he sits down, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes his soul and he dies. And they all died like that in that state. Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ أَعْثَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ. And that is how we made them discovered. Yani, in other words, they died and they were still hungry. They died and nothing entered their stomach. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala filled their hearts with so much deen that He did not want them to leave this dunya with something of the dunya inside of them. Because their heart was full of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved them and was jealous over them to the point He did not want anything of this dunya to enter their heart and to enter their stomachs, because of their heart being full with the iman and the conviction and the certainty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They left this dunya hungry and they will be fed in the paradise. That is where the believer's life is. That is where his comfort is. That is where his meal is. Subhanallah. وَكَذَلِكَ أَعْثَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ. And this is how we made them to be recognized. And this is how they were discovered. Subhanallah. When the people came, you know, at that time, 300 years after their sleep, now when they woke up and now they're dead, there was a massive, a huge, huge theoretical debate among the Christians. Now at the time, you can say that Islam has been re-established. There are people that are now worshipping and following the authentic teachings of Isa alayhi salam. The deen has been restored into the community. That king and the tyranny has all long gone. And among the Christians, there was a big aqidah debate. The debate was that at the end of time, when Allah resurrects the people, are they going to be resurrected soul only or body and soul? That was a massive issue at the time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the people of the cave discovered. He made them, the people discovered them. Why? لِيَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٍ. So that people get to know that the certainty and the promise. What's the promise of Allah? The hour, the resurrection. That's the promise of Allah. So that the people know that the resurrection is haqq, is certainty. وَأَنَّ السَّاعَةَ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا. And the hereafter, there is absolutely no doubt about it. It's the only reason for why they were discovered. So that the people are convinced about this. And my brothers, I tell you, this is something really important. The more conviction you have about Allah's promise, the more certainty and belief you have about Allah's promise, the closer you get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the less conviction and the less certainty and the far away you're from Allah's promise, which is that you will die and be resurrected once again, the less the iman with a person. Very, very, very important, serious issue. The entire story of the people of the cave was to prove to the people that you will be resurrected body and soul. Just like they were resurrected body and soul. Subhanallah. So Allah says, إِذْ يَتَنَازَعُونَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَمْرَهُمْ. At a time when the people were disputing, is the soul going to be raised or the body and the soul? إِذْ يَتَنَازَعُونَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَمْرَهُمْ. Now look what happened. فَقَالُوا بْنُوا عَلَيْهِمْ بُنْيَانًا رَبُّهُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِهِمْ. They're standing outside this cave. The priests come. The big community leaders come. The Christian priests come in. And they observe, what are they going to do? So these are the same priests that have had a long aqidah discussion for a long time. What's going to be resurrected? The body or body, the soul on its own, or the body on soul? Now watch what happens. Now look what the argument is. Ubnu alayhim bunyan. A group of them said, let's build a monument over them. Let's build like a stone and a monument in honor of these holy saints. قَالَ الَّذِينَ غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ. The people that had more authority in the land, they said, no, we don't want to build a monument. لَنَتَّخِذَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ مَسْجِدًا. We're going to build a masjid right here. The entire debate over decades and decades was this kind of important aqidah issue. Is the body and soul going to be raised or the soul itself? All of a sudden, forget that issue. Let's now talk about, are we going to make a stone here or are we going to build a masjid? And that's all. That became their concern now. What are we going to build? Who's going to build it? In other words, isn't this something that happened in the Ummah of Rasulullah? That we abandoned the main and the major and the important issues and we ran to something trivial like that? A stone, build a stone. What's a stone? Build any stone you want, build whatever you want. Go back to the main issue. How many times has this happened in a community like this? At a time like this? When a aqidah issue is presented and mentioned, don't speak about it. Don't speak about it. You're causing division, you're causing hatred, you're causing disunity, you're the fault. What do you mean? What do you mean? Let's speak about DAs for a masjid. Let's speak about, you know, extending the masjid. Let's speak about renovation for the masjid. Why is this more important than that? When you do that and make this kind of issue more important than an aqidah issue, you've done exactly what these people did at that time, which is something that Allah was disgusted by. So He recorded how horrible their conversation became. And it's just about to get a lot worse. Allah says, now سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. Among each other, later on the Christians would come and they would say, I think they were three and the fourth one was the dog. Others would say, they were five and the sixth was the dog. La. Allah said, رَجْمًا بِالْغَيْبِ. They're just throwing stones in the dark. Yani chucking wild guesses. وَيَقُولُونَ. And some of them would say, سَبْعَةٌ وَثَامِنُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. They were seven and the eighth was the dog. In other words, people didn't learn anything. The entire lesson of Surah Al-Kahf and Ashab Al-Kahf was greater than all of this. They're sitting down now discussing. They're debating, should we build a stone, a masjid? Forget that now. Let's speak about how much they were. I say there were three. No. I say there were four. Then actually there were five. There were seven. The eighth was... Well, what does that got to do with the story? Yani, Sheikh Ratib al-Nabilsi, hafizahullah, he mentions an incredible example on the understanding of this. Let me tell you this. He says, suppose, the way he explained it is amazing. Yani, to teach us, what ayah is this, what lesson is this ayah teaching us? Really, what is it teaching us? He said, let's say, let me tell you now, that there's a professional and there's a highly experienced businessman. Very successful, mashallah, millions and millions of dollars in his account, billions of dollars. And I said to you boys, I'm going to get him for you for 1 hour. He's gonna sit down in front of you and he's going to give you a lesson on how to be successful in the business like him and make money like him. So everyone attends and he comes in and he begins and he says, look, this is my secret skills. Do this, do that. And before you open the business, you got to look into the product and you got to see if it's selling in the area or not. And then you got to open somewhere where, you know, you'll drag attention at people. And he speaks for an hour and he's done. And he says, okay, does anyone have a question now? So then one of you says, I know, I've got a question. Now, top one. He says, can you tell us what is the color of the socks you wear to work? Color of the socks. Leave someone else. Someone else, mashallah, has a question. Now, do you wear a jacket to work or not? I mean, what's this question? Yani, subhanAllah, this is the idea of the ayah. To tell us that were so many important lessons. Look what the people eventually asked. How many were they? What was the color of the dog? What type of dog was it? These are like questions. What's the Iblis, his wife, what's her name? Right, these are the questions people ask, irrelevant questions. He won't do anything for you. Allah Azza wa Jalla, and he ends with a powerful lesson as an introduction. Learn how to write how to ask the correct and the most appropriate questions. The important questions, right? قُلْ رَبِّ. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla says to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how do you deal with this issue? قُلْ رَبِّ أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ. Just say Allah knows how many they were. So what? Big deal. They were one, they were 10, they were 100. What's it going to change of the story? قُلْ رَبِّي أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ مَا يَعْلَمُهُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. No one knows them except a few. فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ إِلَّا مِرَاءً ظَاهِرًا. يعني لا تُمَارِ. Don't debate, don't sit there and discussion after discussion except with solid evidence. What kind of proof do you have that they were this or that or that? No proof. So don't argue, just go ahead. وَلَا تَسْتَفْتِ فِيهِمْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدًا. And don't seek a fatwa from any one of them, of these Christians that came later on, and that's all they discussed, the color of the dog and the number of the people and how many they were and what was happening and so on. SubhanAllah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَا تَسْتَفْتِ فِيهِمْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدًا. وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا. That actually has a reason for why this ayah came down. Don't say to anything that you're going to do tomorrow. إِلَّا يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. Except that you say, inshallah, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيرٌ. And make mention of your Lord when you forget it. Yani in other words, if I said to you, I'm gonna come to your place today. And I forgot, 2 hours later I remembered I didn't say inshallah. I'll call you after 2 hours and say inshallah. He said, well, what's this inshallah? Don't worry, sorry. Yani wadhkur rabbaka ila nasir. Just say it. If you forgot to say it the moment you remember it. You sent the message and you forgot to say inshallah, after 3 hours send inshallah. He'll send you a question mark, it doesn't matter. But يعني يسمي إن شاء الله واذكر ربك إذا نسيت وقل عسى يهديني ربي لأقرب من هذا رشدا. I just want to conclude with the last ayah. I told you it has a reason, but it's a long reason. Anyway, look at this. ولبثوا في كهفهم. Now, last ayah I said. ولبثوا. They remained in their cave. 300 سنين وازدادوا تسعة. They remained in there for 300 years and they exceeded by 9. What does that mean? 300 and 9 years. Wait, what else? What does that mean? You have a group that said 300 meaning 300 in the lunar count and 309 years in the solar count. What's this? What for? Yani Allah says wazdadu tis'a, meaning they were increased by 9. Allahu a'lam what this 9 was. Could be 9 hours. Wazdadu 9 days. 9 months, 9 years. Now it doesn't matter. Look, Allah just taught the lesson above. He taught you how to ask the right question, how to ask a right question. Now you come to the ayah. If people began to discuss, that means they didn't learn the lesson yet. So Allah Azza wa Jalla will teach the lesson one more time. The ayah after it, He says, قُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثُوا. Just say Allah knows how long they remain. What difference is it gonna make? They lasted 9,000 years or 300 years. What difference is it going to make? This is exactly like the question of how many were they? What color the dog was? Subhanallah. And you know, the best thing is, the beautiful thing is, that lesson of asking the right and intelligent question as a Muslim came in Surah Al-Kahf and at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf. Because every single story that is going to follow after this story, which is the three after it, this is where the people ask the silliest questions you've ever heard. Now, when you get close to the story of Musa al-Khadr, what's the question that people ask? Who's al-Khadr? Is he still alive? Khadr. We heard he's still alive. Is he? They go, what? Yeah, I mean, what? And then when you get to Dhul-Qarnayn at the end, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, is that the wall of China? Did Ya'juj and Ma'juj come out yet? People didn't learn their lesson from the very beginning. You're supposed to have learned to ask the right and intelligent question from the beginning. It's all right, it's good to ask the question, but learn to ask the intelligent and the right question. A question that'll take you somewhere, that'll increase your iman in something. How many they were? What, that doesn't increase your iman in anything. Well, Khadr is alive or not, what kind of iman is that gonna increase? Whether it was the Great Wall of China or something else, what kind of iman is that gonna increase? And take it upon anything you hear in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. Learn to ask a question that'll benefit you in your deen. That'll benefit you in your deen, right? Yani, subhanAllah, this is the final lesson that is learned in the story of the people of the cave. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us like these people that had this certainty and conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, they had not a single second, not an ounce of doubt in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By the way, please, one more point. You know, these Ashab al-Kahf, they walked in the correct way and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them so many miracles and so many help and aid. And you know, if I was right now, I told you yesterday, I went to Canberra, let's say. I went to Canberra and I say, oh brothers, wallahi, something amazing happened. Every 500 meters I drive, this didn't happen, but I'm just saying, every 500 meters, they'd stop us and they gave us a laptop. We drove 500 meters, they stopped us and they gave us a phone. 500 meters, they stopped us, they gave us $500. And you ask me the whole way. Every 500 meters, we're stopped and they gave us something. You're gonna ask me, well, Yani, where's this reward? How can I get it? What am I gonna say to you? Go the same path I went and you'll get the same thing. Go into the same path I went, you'll get the same thing. Some people sit down and complain. How come Allah doesn't give me anything? But you're walking on the same path as Ashab al-Kahf for Allah to give you. Walk in the same path of the righteous. Walk in the same path of the righteous that Allah gave and showered. And 120,000 miracles happened for these people and even more than that. Walk in their path and Allah would give. But Allah doesn't hold back. but walk in the correct path, in the right path, and Allah would give. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the correct path. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people of the Qur'an, people who benefit from the reminders of the Qur'an. إِنَّهُ وَلِيَ ذَلِكَ الْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهُ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ.